Well, folks, good morning. It is lovely to see you all this morning. We are just going to begin our service together with a couple of verses from Colossians in chapter 1. Just a very short little reading. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, speaking about Jesus, speaking about who Jesus is as we meet together in worship this morning. Colossians 1, verse 15 says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence." And so we want to give Jesus Christ the preeminence this morning. We want to meet together to worship him, to praise him. And so we'll stand together with the words of our first hymn this morning in praise. We're going to sing, "This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made." So we'll stand together and sing. So you are very welcome if you've just joined us during the first hymn, and a special word of welcome as well for David Bissett, who's with us to bring God's word with us this morning. It's lovely to have you with us, and we look forward to what you're going to share. So we're just going to open our service now in prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege it is, Lord, to be able to gather together in this way, Lord. Even as we have just sung there, we remember, Lord, that this is your day, Lord. This is your creation, Lord. We thank you for the beauty of the sunshine and the rain even that we've had over the past few days, Lord. And they only remind us of your power and of your might and of your glory. And yet, Lord, this morning we meet together, able to freely draw into your presence, Lord, to meet with you. And we thank you for that privilege. And Lord, as we do that this morning, Lord, as we meet with you and you speak to us from your word this morning, Lord, I just pray that you would be with us all, Lord, in all parts of the service. We pray for the musicians, Lord. We pray for your servant as he brings your word to us, Lord. We pray for those who would look after Junior Church, that you would be a help. Lord, as we consider your word and consider you this morning, Lord, I pray that you would speak to us and that you would give us hearts that are ready to hear your word. Lord, you know where we all are this morning. You know what's going on in our lives, Lord. You know all the different distractions and things that can come into our heads, Lord. And I just pray that you would meet with us in a very real and true, close way this morning, Lord, and speak to us. And that those who are in need of comfort this morning, Lord, that you would grant them comfort in your word. that those who are in need perhaps of conviction, Lord, that you would convict people of their need of you. Those who are in need of being stirred up, Lord, that you would challenge us this morning, that you would meet each of us as we need. And so, Lord, we just pray for your blessing upon our service this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to think together with the boys and girls just for a little bit, very quickly, this morning. We have a few away on holidays, but we have a few here as well this morning that we can think together a wee bit with. And we're going to think a little bit about some languages that maybe you don't understand. And we're going to think a little bit about learning some new languages this morning, because it's that time of year where we're all going to start going away places, and it can be really handy if you know the odd wee phrase here and there to go away on your holidays. It can be really useful. We're going to expose my lack of language knowledge and my terrible accent here, but our first one, does anybody know what language this is? It says, bonjour, ça va? Does anybody know what language bonjour, ça va is? Leah, do you know what language that is? It is French. Can anybody tell me what bonjour, ça va means? This is about the only French, really, I remember from school, apart from one other sentence that we're going to look at in a minute. Holly, what does it mean? Hello, how are you? Bonjour, ça va? Well done, very impressed, very, very good. Here we are. Here's the one French sentence that I remember, really, apart from bonjour, ça va. Je n'aime pas parler en français. Does anybody know what je n'aime pas parler en français means? Some of the adults are chuckling. Some of the more intelligent adults are chuckling. Does anybody know what that means? Holly again. I don't like speaking French. That used to get me away with a lot of things in French class. So long as I could say that was okay. Okay, here's another one. Does anybody know what hola means? What does hola mean? Or do we know what language it is? Leah again. It means hello. Do you know what language it is? It is Spanish. Someone has shouted it out for us there. Brilliant. It is Spanish. Here's another useful Spanish phrase, puedo tener un helado. This is a good one if you're on your holidays. Does anybody know what that means in Spanish? We have drawn a blank. No Spanish experts in the room. It means, can I have an ice cream, please? That's what you need on your holidays, can I have an ice cream? But before we get to go on holidays, before you get to go away somewhere else in July and learn a different language, I want to tell you about a different language this morning, a different language that some of you don't understand at all, a different language that you encounter quite often, you will hear quite often, but I don't really think you know what it means, and it's something that you might find yourself having to be able to speak this week. Here's the language that you might have to speak this week. It is the language of school reports, because I'm going to let you in on a secret. Whenever teachers are writing your school reports, they don't always write the truth. They don't always really say what they want to say. They don't always really say what they mean. And so I'm going to show you some things that you might see on your school report, and we're going to tell you what it really means, just in case you see some of these sentences in your school report. Are you ready for the first one? He's not here this morning, but first one, well, we'll go Thomas Strange. Thomas is a lively and enthusiastic pupil. That's something that you might see on your school report. Does anybody want to guess what Thomas is a lively and enthusiastic pupil really means? Because when your teacher says that, it means something. I'm going to translate it for you into normal English. This means Thomas talks far too much and is never quiet. He can be a bit annoying. But we're not allowed to write that on your school report. So if you see that this week on your school report, that's what it really means. You talk too much and you're a bit annoying. Here's another one. Holly has the ability to do very well. What could that one mean? Holly has the ability to do very well. Here we go. It means Holly is lazy and doesn't try very hard in class. I mean, she could do well, but she never really bothers herself. She's far too lazy and she looks appalled. Next one. There's only a couple to go. Jessica has done some really good work this year when she has been concentrating. That one's maybe a bit more obvious. I write that one quite often. This means Jessica drives me crazy because she never concentrates and she distracts everyone else. That's what it really means. And I think the last one, Jack is always keen to take part in lessons. What could that one mean? Jack is always keen to take part in lessons. It means Jack shouts out all the time and doesn't give anybody else a chance to answer any questions. That's what it means. You see, your teachers don't always tell you the truth. We have to find a nice way of saying things, things that we don't really want to say. We don't really get to tell you what we really mean. And I was wondering if we were to look in the Bible about what God says about us, would we find it like that? Would we be able to trust what it says in the Bible about us? Does God really know what we are like? Does God really know us? And is he really able to tell us what we're like? Or does God just try to be nice to us and say some of these nice sort of things that we read in school reports? And the good thing is, boys and girls, whenever we read about ourselves in the Bible, God tells us the truth. He tells us exactly what we're really like, because God really knows us. And it's important that we know the truth. And sometimes when I'm writing school reports, I wish I could just write the truth and it would be much more useful. But God tells us the truth because he knows exactly what we're like. And right the way back, all the way back in Genesis, very near the beginning of the world, God knew exactly what we were like. And in Genesis chapter 6, right near the start of the Bible, God looks down at the world and he looks at all of the people in the world and he says, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth and that every intent of the thought of his heart was only evil." In other words, all of humanity, all humans, all men and women and boys and girls, they have wickedness and they have sin, and all they ever seem to want to do is the wrong thing. You see, God looks at us and he doesn't just see what we do on the outside. He knows what we're thinking on the inside. He knows what we want to do. He knows why we're doing everything. And he knows that quite often when we're doing things, it's for the wrong reason. And he knows that we are sinners. And he tells us that. He doesn't come up with a nice way of saying it in the Bible. Instead, he tells us the truth. And further on in the Old Testament, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, God says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" In other words, we can't trust men and women and boys and girls. They're deceitful. Their hearts are deceitful. Sometimes we even tell ourselves that we're doing things for a good reason, but we're not. We're doing things just to make ourselves look good. We're doing things because we're proud and we want other people to think that we're nice. We're not doing things for the right reason. But God knows that. God knows that we are sinners and that we are full of pride and we do things for the wrong reasons. And God tells us that. He tells us the truth about ourselves. We're sinners, and sometimes we even fool ourselves into thinking that we're better. And in the New Testament, we'll know this verse. This is a famous one. "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." It's important that God tells us the truth. God tells us that we have sin in our hearts and that we will do the wrong thing all the time, and we think the wrong thing and we want to do the wrong thing because we have sin in our hearts. And God tells us that because we need to know the truth. He doesn't sort of hide it behind something else like our school reports. Just one more verse to tell you about, though. This is in Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. And we'll read it, and then we'll just explain a wee bit about what it's saying. It says, "And you who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he is now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him." The start of that little verse talks about us being alienated and hostile. Hostile means that we are working against God. We are going against God. We are God's enemies. And alienated means far away from. So those verses that we read earlier talked about how God knows that we are all sinners. God knows that we have sin in our heart. God knows what we're like. He knows that we sin all the time. And because of that, we are far away from God. We are far away from God, and we are God's enemies. But then it tells us in the middle of that verse about Jesus' death. And because of Jesus' death, it says we can be reconciled. We can be made right. Our relationship with God can be fixed. We don't have to be far away from God and God's enemies. He can make us right. And if we come to Jesus and we ask him to take away our sins, he will take them away and he will make us right. And then the end of the verse tells us what he turns us into once he makes us right. It says that he can make us holy and blameless. That means perfect. And so, boys and girls, this morning I can say that the Bible's right about me. God is right about me. God looks and he knows that I am a sinner. And he knows that I was once far away from him. And he knows that I want to do things that are wrong. But because Jesus has taken my sins away, my school report from God, when he looks at me this morning, would say, Mike is holy and blameless. Mike is perfect, is what my report would say this morning. I have sin in my heart, but God has taken my sins away and forgiven me for my sins. And so my report would say, holy, blameless, and perfect. And that's not God being nice or hiding something. God's telling the truth because he has dealt with my sins and he has taken them away. And boys and girls, I hope that you can say this morning that you've prayed that prayer, that you have come to God and asked him to take your sins away, because he knows what you're like. He knows that you have sin in your heart, but he can make you blameless and holy and perfect. So thank you for listening this morning. Now, we just have a few announcements to go through this morning, and then we'll sing again, and then I get to sit down. So just a few announcements to go through. So this morning, again, you're very welcome. We've got David Bissett with us this morning. Lovely to have you with us. And this evening, we will have Andrew Martin from Ballygowan Presbyterian with us. Just looking forward then to the week ahead. On Wednesday, we have our Bible study and prayer time at 8 o'clock. Thursday morning prayer time at 10 o'clock in the morning. And this is the last morning prayer time until August. And then next Sunday, we have Thomas Saunderson and Andrew Mullen morning and evening. And then just a couple of extra little announcements. If you have volunteered to help at the Holiday Bible Club, particularly if you feel that you are at risk of being asked to do something up at the front, if possible, could you just come up to the front this morning at the end of the service just for 2 minutes? So especially if you think you're at risk of being asked to do something at the front, I have a wee rota that I just want to show you just to check that you're all happy with the jobs that you've been given and you don't want to back out or available on those particular nights. So if you could just pause behind after the service for 2 minutes, that would be really appreciated. I also just want to thank everyone who was involved in the Sunday school outing yesterday at Cornfonnock. We had glorious weather, a good crowd of kids out, and the barbecue was 5-star, Michelin star quality. So thank you very much for those who took part and helped on that. And it was a lovely day. And then just the last wee announcement, just to mention, most of you will be aware about Johnny Galt's motorbike being stolen out in Mozambique. And a number of people have approached Thomas and asked about being able to make some sort of financial contribution to that and to getting Johnny sorted with a new motorbike. So if that's something that you would like to do, you just need to make sure that if you're given any money in envelopes, that if you want it to go to Johnny's motorbike, that you write something about Johnny's motorbike on the envelope and just pop it in the wee basket at the back there, and we'll make sure that anything labelled in that way goes in the right direction. In the same way, I think if you're sending something online via online banking, you can include something about Johnny's motorbike in the reference, and then we can pick that up and make sure that it goes the right direction. So those are our announcements for this morning. We're going to stand and sing together our second hymn, and then I'm going to pass over to David, and I'll have a seat. So we'll stand together and sing these words. Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word.
Thank you.
This was left behind at the barbecue yesterday, the Sunday school barbecue, and if anybody recognizes it, you can come and see me at the end.
Good morning, everyone. It's lovely to be here with you this morning in Straid, to be back amongst you here today. And I was just thinking, as Mike was giving his children's address, I'm 49 years of age, and now I finally understand a couple of items on some of my school reports. So thank you, Mike. And I have to confess again that it was more to do with concentration and application, I think. I can remember, though, my P2 teacher. She said something about me in class that I was able to understand. She called me Joseph one day because I was prone to daydreaming, she said. So it was certainly informative this morning after all these years to understand a few things about some of even my old school reports. Let's turn now, however, to the Word of God. We'll turn now to Daniel chapter 1. The book of Daniel and chapter 1. And we're going to take the time to read the whole of the first chapter of the book of Daniel. Daniel 1, verses 1 to 21. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Aspenaz, master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well-favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who hath appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which are of your sort? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Then said Daniel to Melzar, whom the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat. And as thou seest, deal with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter, and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzar took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink, and gave them pulse. As for these 4 children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the king had said he should bring them in, then the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. And Daniel continued even unto the first year of King Cyrus. Amen. Before we come to the preaching and teaching of God's word this morning, let's come and bow before the Lord in a word of prayer and ask his help in prayer this morning. Our gracious God and the eternal Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy, infallible, and inerrant word. We thank you, our Father and our God, that in the pages of Scripture from Genesis to Revelation are all that we need for life, for salvation, for life, and for godliness. And so as we come and as we have read and as we continue to study that which is written in your word, Lord, give us attentive hearts and ears and help us to set aside every other distracting thought that even now would vie for our attention. Help us to put them to one side that we might give your word our full focus and our full attention. And Lord, as we stand under the authority not of a man but of your word, Lord, we pray that as your people that we might put ourselves under the authority of that word, that you would speak to us through your word, that you would encourage, that you would challenge, that where needed that you would rebuke us, that you would draw those who know you not to you, and that you would draw those of us who do closer to you. And Lord, as we leave this place this morning, help us not to be mere hearers of the word of God, but doers of it also. Lord, give us the strength of your spirit within us to put your word into practice in our daily lives. And Lord, we pray above all things that you might be glorified through the preaching of your word this day. For it's in Jesus' name we ask it and for God's glory. Amen. Amen. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. Judah's king, King Jehoiakim, and ultimately Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah are taken into Babylonian captivity as God's promised judgment upon the people, the Old Testament people of God. They're taken into Babylonian captivity as God's judgment upon Judah because of their continual sin and their continual idolatry. Of course, this is something that the prophets of God had warned the people and foretold. Prophets such as Jeremiah in Jeremiah 20, verses 4 and 5. For thus saith the Lord, I will give all Judah into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall carry them captive into Babylon, and shall slay them with the sword. Moreover, I will deliver all the strength of this city, and all the labors thereof, and all the precious things thereof, and all the treasures of the kings of Judah will I give into the hand of their enemies, which shall spoil them, and take them, and carry them to Babylon. And this happened exactly and precisely as God had promised and warned in the third year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. And right at the outset, this reminds you and I that God always keeps his promises and always judges unrepentant sin and sinners in the end. As Guzik puts it here in his commentary, God always settles accounts with those who refuse to respond to his warnings. Nebuchadnezzar looted the temple at Jerusalem, and he took some of its treasures and its furnishings, taking them back to Babylon and the house of his God. To Nebuchadnezzar, this showed that the God of Babylon is greater than the God of Israel. However, the God of Judah and Israel, the only true and living God, would be sure to show this wicked, idolatrous, pagan king that this was not the case. As indeed, as we go on in Daniel, and particularly the opening four chapters of Daniel, we see that happening. We see that process happening, showing that despite the sin of Judah and the people of God, God was still the only true and living God. And indeed, even this pagan king, King Nebuchadnezzar himself, would ultimately declare and confirm of the true and living God in Daniel 4, verse 34 to 35. And at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up mine eyes unto heaven, and mine understanding returned unto me, and I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that liveth forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation, and all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing, and he doeth according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say unto him, what doest thou? And for any of us who know Nebuchadnezzar at the start of the book of Daniel, he's a very different man at the end of Daniel chapter 4. A man who was all about fulfilling his will. A man who wasn't content with being the head of gold. He wanted to be a whole statue of gold, but yet ultimately was humbled by God and brought to this conclusion, that God and God alone doeth according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say unto him, what doest thou? Of course, the Bible reminds us that a day is coming when all will bow and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, that the kings, queens, presidents, and prime ministers will one day acknowledge that he is Lord, from the greatest to the least. Then secondly, we see Daniel's training, verse 3 to 4. And the king spake unto Aspenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom and cunning and knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. Nebuchadnezzar here had the cream of Israelites' youth taken to Babylon. Young men in their formative years, probably between the ages of 13 and 17 years of age, that they might be trained and Babylonized to drive the Hebrew out of them, so that they would become good little Babylonians, putting their skills and training to use in the service of the Babylonian state. Amongst them here are Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, four Hebrew teenagers. Surely, on the face of it at least, humanly speaking, these four were bound to lose their Israelite identity and their faith in the only true and living God and become good, idolatrous Babylonians. And so their intense Babylonian training began. But first, let's look at Daniel and his companions here in verses 5 to 7. The king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. Daniel was not on his own. He had three friends. Three friends that in many ways would prove to be kindred spirits: Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. They were to partake daily of King Nebuchadnezzar's meat and wine for 3 years. The prince of the eunuchs gave them new Babylonian names. Daniel's Hebrew name, which meant God is my judge, was changed to Belteshazzar, which meant Bel's prince. Hananiah's name, which meant beloved by the Lord, was changed to Shadrach, which meant illumined by sun god. Mishael's name, which meant who is as God, was changed to Meshach, which meant the Lord, which meant who is like Venus. Apologies, I'm skipping on too far. Azariah's name, which meant the Lord is my help, was changed to Abednego, meaning servant of Nego. Each name changed from speaking of and from referring to the true and living God to speaking of and referring to the false gods of Babylon. This, of course, was no accident. This was deliberate. It was all deliberate. The reason for the new food, the new names, and the Babylonian education was simple. This was an attempt at total indoctrination to drive the Hebrew out of these four Hebrew young men, that they might forget about their Hebrew culture and, most importantly, their Hebrew God. And still, of course, today Satan wants to indoctrinate us, and particularly to indoctrinate our children and teenagers and young people. Satan wants to indoctrinate us and our children into the world's system and the world's way of thinking. Sadly, already today, many professed Christians have compromised due to pressure from the world to conform to the world's immorality on issues such as abortion, same-sex marriage, and other prominent moral issues of our day. And we have saw numerous professed believers totally capitulate to the pressure from our current Western world culture to conform. Many have just allowed themselves to be indoctrinated and compromised by the world, when the Bible has clearly commanded and warned us in Romans 12 and 2, be not conformed to this world. Here in the midst of this godless culture, an alien worldview, we see in verse 8 Daniel's resolution. And how we need Daniel's, Hananiah's, Mishael's, and Azariah's today. But Daniel, it says, purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Daniel and his three friends, four teenagers, despite the ruling Babylonian worldview under whose dominion they found themselves, being totally opposite to their own, still these four purposed in their hearts not to defile themselves, purposed in their hearts not to conform to the Babylonian world and worldview in which they now found themselves, and refused to sin against God by partaking in food that was first sacrificed to idols. And be in no doubt, Nebuchadnezzar didn't just take four young men, from Judah. There are many others, I'm sure, who quite easily went along to get along. But not Daniel and his friends. Again, the commentator Guzik points out also, this implied fellowship with Babylonian's cultural system, this partaking of this food that was first sacrificed to idols also implied fellowship with Babylonian's cultural system. There was no just going along here to get along with these four teenagers. No, as it were, Belteshazzar, Daniel would not bow to these new names, nor these new conditions of the Babylonian culture. And in the words of Acts 5:29, these young men said, in effect, we ought to obey God rather than men. They said, we will not conform to this world. And not only did they say it to themselves and to God, they went and they requested of the prince of the eunuchs that they might not defile themselves. Daniel and his three friends, they weren't silent about their intention. They weren't silent about their purpose not to conform to the Babylonian decree and defile themselves in the sight of their God. And sadly today, the same cannot be said when it comes to refusing to conform to the immoral and sinful worldviews in our world today. How we need in our day, like Daniel and his three friends, men who will refuse to conform, will refuse to just keep quiet, to just keep their heads down and their mouths shut, and just go along to get along, but instead will stand up and speak up and say, we must obey God rather than men. To say, abortion is murder, same-sex marriage is sin, a man is still a man, even if he decides he wants to be known as a woman. Just because everyone else in the world is saying love is love, it's loving, accepting good and right, does not make it so. The Word of God is our standard, not the world. As Bonhoeffer said, silence in the face of evil is itself evil. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. We must speak the truth in our day to our culture. We must speak the truth. We must be clear. We must not apologize for the truth of Scripture. I was listening to the American preacher, Dr. Vody Bauckham, in a little clip. And he stood up and he started, and the start of it would really confuse you. He stood up and he started to say, I love wife beaters. I want you to know I have friends who are wife beaters. And I want you to know that I'm not here today to be getting at wife beaters. And he then started to make sense out of what he was saying. Because he said, almost every sermon I see or hear on the internet or other places that's speaking about homosexuality or same-sex marriage and abortion and all these things, they start with an apology, something akin to that. And yet we wouldn't make the same kind of apology to any other group of sinners. We need to stop apologizing, folks, for the Word of God. We need to confront men and women with their sin and call them to repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We dare not coddle people in their sin and make them comfortable as they rush headlong to hell. We must have courage to speak the truth. Daniel's request then, verse 9 to 13, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat, and as thou seest, deal with thy servants. As a former Southern Baptist Convention president, Adrian Rogers, said many years ago, and rightly so, the faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. Well, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and you and I, Christian, have a faith in the only true and living God that can be tested and thus can be trusted. And Daniel and his three friends were willing to be tested, confident, not in themselves, but confident in their God and in their faith in God, that they would indeed be vindicated, with a similar confidence to Job, who declared in Job 23 and 10, but he knoweth the way that I take, and when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. And so we come then to the test results. I'm speaking about school reports earlier on. Here we come to Daniel's test results. Verses 14 to 16. So he consented to them in this matter and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzar took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink and gave them pulse. And as Ephesians 3 and 20 testifies, our God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And this is one of those occasions when he did just exactly that. Firstly, God moved the prince of the eunuchs to agree to this test in the first place. So he consented to them in this matter and proved them 10 days. Secondly, there was no reason why a vegetarian diet would make Daniel and his three friends appear fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. And therefore, truly we can exclaim with the psalmist in the words of Psalm 118 and 23, this is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Thus also Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah's faith and trust in God was vindicated. As 1 John 5 and 4 declares to us, this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. These four men determined to stand upon their faith, to stand upon their principles for God and godliness. And God was pleased to vindicate these four young men at this time. And then there was a final exam. Finals day came, verse 17 to 21. As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the king had said he should bring them in, then the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar, and the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. These young Jewish men gave themselves to the Lord in a remarkable way, and God blessed them in a remarkable way. For Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah's their knowledge, their skill, their wisdom, and Daniel's understanding in all visions and dreams was God-given. Also showing that those who put God first will find that they have been given the gifts, the skills, the knowledge, and the wisdom that they require, as God's word promises in Matthew 6 and 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. God will give us that which we require. And here Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were four young teenagers thrown into the full-on intensive study of Babylonian culture, customs, literature, religion. And yet throughout it all, they remained faithful and they remained true to God and His Word. It must have seemed to prophets like Jeremiah, Zephaniah, and Habakkuk, and others who had faithfully proclaimed the Word of God and the warning of God in the years just before the Babylonian captivity, that no one listened, that no one heeded their teachings. Zephaniah and Habakkuk and Jeremiah and the others had not, their teaching, their preaching had not been in vain when it came to these four young teenagers. And probably their parents also, who had clearly followed the command of God in Proverbs 22 and 6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Someone had faithfully taught these young men. Most likely their parents, and parents, no one hands us a manual when we receive our newborn into our arms. Remember in 2006, February the 25th, receiving my newborn daughter into my arms, and this feeling of full afraid that I would drop her, and just feeling so out of my depths. And as parents, we don't only feel like that on that first day, we continue to feel like that. And we make so many mistakes. And we have so many failures. But yet through it all, God helps us to learn from our failures, to learn from our mistakes. But as the Lord's people, may God help us not to make the biggest mistake of all with our children and not bring them up in the fear and the admonition of the Lord, that we would train up our children in the way that they should go, that we would be transparent about our own faults, our own failings, our own shortcomings, and that we might even use our own failings as teaching moments for our children to explain to them that this is why we ourselves need a Savior, because we sin, we fail, we let them down at times. And that through it all, successes, failures, mistakes, that we would teach our children faithfully the ways of God, the Word of God, the way of salvation, how to walk in this world. Increasingly, the Western world in particular is becoming a more and more hostile place for our children. I personally don't hold to premillennial dispensationalism, that we're going to be raptured out before the trouble comes. Godly men have believed that. I'm not here to have a debate about it. I'm not here to have a fight or an argument about it. But folks, it's my firm belief that we need to be preparing our children for what's coming. We need to be preparing them to be Daniels, Hananias, Mishaels, and Azarias, to take their stand, to know what they believe, why they believe it, to be able to stand in this day and in the days that are to come and not wither and fade and just be consumed by the immoral and wicked culture in which we live today. But what an encouragement also these four young men are to faithful but discouraged preachers of the gospel today, who, like Jeremiah, Zephaniah, Habakkuk, and others, often feel no one has listened or heeded their preaching, their warnings. God's Word is where we find our encouragement. We find our encouragement in these four young men And we find our encouragement in the Word of God in verses such as this: shall not, God's Word shall not return unto God void, but it shall accomplish that which He pleases, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto God sent it. These faithful prophets' preaching bore fruit, and fruit that would and did remain under the most testing, under the most trying of circumstances, in Babylonian captivity for 70 years. And what a wonderful reminder it is to all faithful preachers of the gospel, even today, as 1 Corinthians 15 and 58 declares, know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. It's God's Word. And God's Word will always hit its mark, will always have an effect. Your labors are not in vain. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding, the king inquired of them. He found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. And Daniel continued, even under the first year of King Cyrus. As Guzik concludes, Daniel and his friends show us that inner conviction can overcome any outer pressure, and that God-honoring convictions yield God-given rewards. Of course, the rewards don't always come in this life with deliverance. Sometimes, like a chapter or two later, it means us going through the fire, even though perhaps at the end of that we're plucked out from the burning. Other times, it may mean laying down our earthly lives. But whatever the circumstances, the promise of God remains true, as we find it in 1 Samuel 2 and 30. Them that honor me, I will honor. Folks, as Christians, we live and we witness and we serve at the end of the day to please only an audience of one, and that is God. And the way the culture is going, increasingly, we are pleasing fewer and fewer people. Be that as it may, may God strengthen us as He strengthened Daniel and his friends, that we would honor Him first, foremost, and forever. And therefore, Christian today, and with this I close, and Christian every day, as the old children's chorus said, dare to be a Daniel. Dare to stand alone. Dare to have a purpose firm. And dare to make it known. May God help us. Amen. We're going to sing our closing hymn this morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. I must stand to sing.
Amen.
We thank you for your great and eternal faithfulness. Faithfulness that we can see on every page, in every book of Scripture, Old Testament and New. And even in the story of these four young Hebrew men, we see your faithfulness. Despite all the idolatry and sin that was around them in their own land, and then the overwhelming culture of sin and immorality in Babylon, you saved these young men. You kept these young men. And you used these young men mightily. Truly we can say, great is your faithfulness. Truly we can say, all we have needed, your hand has provided. Great is your faithfulness, Lord, unto me. And so we can trust you in our day and for whatever lies ahead in the days that are to come, that all that we have need of you will continue to provide. That we too in our day may continue to stand firm for thee and continue to serve thee. And we pray that as we do, we would bring glory and honor to the name of our God and our Savior. For it's in Jesus' name we ask it, and for God's glory. Amen.